Very, very thankful to Dr. Karnika Seth, who has been very, very nice to accommodate her talk post lunch. It is our privilege indeed to have Dr. Karnika Seth. She's a cyber law expert and founding partner at Seth Associates. She's going to be talking today about data protection in the world of data science and discuss the best practices that every data scientist must adopt to comply with laws of privacy and data protection. In times of AI/ML, her talk will focus on the crucial role of data scientists in creating innovative products without faltering on the legal compliance. Through vivid examples and use cases, she will discuss do's and don'ts of the world of data scientists. She will conclude by cutting out a checklist of dexterity, which will be useful as a reference point and resource for all of the future data scientists. So I present to you Dr. Karnika Seth. Please scan the QR code.
Very good afternoon, everyone. I know post lunch, there are thoughts whether we should continue listening to these sessions, but I think it's worth it. And we are all, as speakers and the community, trying to give you our best possible in the 15-20 minute time window that we've been assigned. So here I come from the world of law. And when we say law, definitely data protection, privacy, and you know, there are lots of important topics we are all looking at, especially when it comes to data science. A lot of it has to do with ethics. And today, my talk is really revolving around what data scientists must do or must not do when they're on their task or on their job. You all have a very wonderful job. It is to make people's life easier, more convenient, processes becoming more efficient. So while you're doing your job, where does the governance come into picture, and how you must safeguard yourself also while you create this innovation? So it's a very important question. Tomorrow you should not be liable for something that you did not even intend committing. So that's the whole talk about, and I think it'll be of good value add to you for the day. So next. Now you look at this. We all in 70s used to talk about Star Trek, isn't it? So it's all now a reality. All those tricorders, Vulcan mind meld, somebody touching another robot and person, and there would be a scanning of the mind. You can actually read like a CCTV, you can see the mind of the person. All these things are not far from reality today. They're all actually becoming a reality. And fortunately, I have a mentor to Hatron, which is near Haryana. There is a startup incubation center by the government of Haryana. And there I've actually had the occasion to see drones being made, small devices, IoT-based devices, which are able to talk to children. There are things like a robot serving you a drink. So these are all real life scenarios today, and I'm so excited that the topic is fascinating. So let's proceed. So this day, as Rama also, I think Dr. Rama was pointing out, it's no more, it's like no more magic. It's actually happening in for real. Next. Now, so as I appreciate what all you do when you make any kind of algorithm or you develop an app or some sort of a data science analytics is involved, I know the hands-on work that you do requires profiling of automated content. A lot of it could be locked by passwords. A lot of it could be raw data. A lot of it could be certain data which is confidential in nature. It could be health records. There's so many different kinds of data we have. So the thing which we are trying to avoid is the black box scenario. What do we mean by the black box scenario? Whatever decisions you are taking while you're doing the analytics or while you're developing your scientific products should not be something which is opaque, should be transparent. That is what is very, very essential. And when we talk about transparency, you have to deploy your own ethics into your work. That is what you have to translate your ethics into your word, and what those code of ethics are, we are here to talk today. So let's think about this authors versus guild case. You would have all seen Google Books. In the search engine, you have free books. There was once a case that this search algorithm which the Google developed, looking into the search keywords that people are using, is it breaching copyright or not? The US courts held, after a long, you know, series of cases, that no, it did not infringe people's copyright. It only built it for the efficiency and convenience perspective. There was no breach. So that's an important thing which I wanted to point out. So not everything that you do can be put in the infringement category. Okay, so there's a lot you can do. Next, please. This is a very wonderful case study. You know, Amazon, when it was recruiting its teams and people, what glitch came in their algorithm? What was the glitch? The glitch was there were numerous applications, mostly men applying for a job in Amazon. Who doesn't want a job in Amazon, isn't it? But then the algorithm had a problem. It gave automatic preference to a male candidate simply because the data which was input had more number of applicants from men category. So they realized this after a long, you know, observation, and they corrected it. So this is exactly what I'm saying. Bias sometimes can be deliberate because it is something which is ingrained in the mind of the developer and reflects on the work. It could be even unintended because of a situation which has happened in this case, right? Next. Look at this man. He's Professor Guha, and he also advocates what I'm trying to advocate today, that when we do data science and when we perform our work and the roles, we can act out of ethics. We do need a code of ethics and responsible data science today. And that's what AI and ethics, even Professor Guha in the US talks about. Next, risky or responsible. Imagine the impact. A person can be sentenced behind bars for 6 long years because of an AI-based algorithm in the US court which replaces a jury and says, this man can be dangerous if he's, you know, let to be out of the jail. So rather than a parole, he would be given a 6 long year imprisonment. So this is how it could impact in the judicial system, where US courts are already using AI-based algorithms to, you know, say whether this person is guilty or not and what should be the sentence. Even children, for that matter, if they commit crimes, they are being run through the algorithms. Their data, historical track of their behavior is being put in like an input into the algorithm to see whether there would be recidivism, you know. So then this is how serious it can get. So then we have to know there's a new momentum. There is a whole new movement around data science right now across the world. What is it talking about? I've read numerous Harvard papers, and I have seen from various universities, professors write that it is not clear how these systems are making decisions. When they take into account gender, for example, or a zip code of a location or a locality, and they're putting in data, is there enough transparency? Is there elimination of bias, to cut it short, right? Now, in Idaho, there was a law which was passed specifying the methods and the data which is used in bail algorithms must be publicly available so that they could question it if there is something wrong. The source code of a software can be questioned. The process behind it, the data which goes into it, everything should be questionable, right? Next. So this is one of the papers which I really liked when I read it. It basically talked about, and it starts with a very interesting line, algorithms are eating the world, right? And then it says, from every industry, education to health, finance to media, all are embracing algorithm methods, which is true. But the only worry which this paper discusses is that the parole boards, which are relying on the algorithms to reduce recidivism risk, is okay, but they have to be used within compliance of law, right? So one of these softwares, Compass, was being used, you know, this another case study. In State versus Loomis was the first case of data science where algorithm was questioned. And the court said, the Supreme Court of Wisconsin said, that the use of proprietary risk assessment tool called Compass was basically there to check the recidivism, whether somebody will actually commit crimes again or not, what should be done, should we sentence him or not. So it did not violate the due process rights of this person. So that was said in that particular trial that was, you know, looked into whether the source code had a problem when it computed whether this recidivism is possible or not. So source code was held to be logic, based on logic. But what they did not see, and this paper discusses, is that your logic and your source code is intact, fine. But what goes in is the input data. Have you questioned the input data? In this case, input data was not questioned. And what this paper discusses is that there was a bias against black people in the US. So automatically, this man would have a problem because of the input data. And nobody questioned that in the courts. So that's a very interesting way of looking at various case scenarios in this paper. Is very interesting from that perspective. Next. Next, please. Okay, so this only shows the number of, you know, different, I would say, segments in which AI is useful. And in one of the real life, you know, scenarios I've actually dealt with is a health data. I'm currently working on a project, very interesting project, where I'm looking at the various data which an app will collect, linking health service providers and patients across India. And that health app is a challenge because a lot of consent requirement is there, specific consent. Okay, for the new patients, you can still take. What about the 10-year-old data which is lying with the service provider? How does he upload that digitally on the app? And now if they try to take permission from a 10-year-old patient who they serviced 10 years ago, nobody will give it, right? So the risk is much more, and the compliance requirement is much grave. And I have warned him, in case he takes this data online, on the app, it can be dangerous without the consent. Next, please. So if you look at, you know, there's one, you can always go through this. Data Science Association has given some good code of ethics, and I found them pretty interesting. I'll just list 4 or 5 of the key pointers here. One is that data, you have to have consent, explicit consent for the data. You just don't go on an app and you try to download and click on I agree without reading its terms and conditions. For God's sake, we're all educated people. Data scientists obviously need to be cautious on that as well. Next. And we must check conflict of interest. And we should also see whether we are compliant with the local law. Are we servicing clients only in India or are we servicing clients abroad? If Europe, then GDPR compliance is necessary. So compliance of law and trying to work with the raw data within the confines of law is what is required. And the PDP bill in India will govern most part of, you know, our way in which we will work with the data science data, in fact. So one of the very interesting, I would say, duties which I felt was to declare transparency in whatever you're doing and not doing cherry picking of data results. So you should be honest to the, you know, purpose and the objective of creation of data. Next, please. Okay, so, and whatever evidence you've collected, in case you have made an algorithm, you keep your source code intact. And the original code has to be intact as well, because that can be used as electronic evidence in the court to prove or disprove an infringement also. Next, please. So these are all a list of practices where I think cooperation with law enforcement becomes very important, especially if you have to prove your innocence. So that's the idea, that when you're using AI or ML, the decryption mechanisms are kept intact, and any anonymized data is only used as anonymized data, not otherwise. Next, please. So I won't go with the GDPR. I think we have already talked about this. Next. Again, we have discussed the right to transparency, and that's okay. Next. Discrimination and model bias. There is a reason code data robot. I think these are all techniques which you can use for explaining the model and the logic behind it. Next. We have discussed the PDP. Next, please. Okay. So, beauty pageant. There was a beauty pageant in India 1 or 2 years ago where there was again a glitch, or again a real life scenario, where beauty pageant algorithm in, you know, for selection used skin color as a fair skin color to be a preferable, you know, trait. So that's again a glitch which came and it was eliminated later. Next. That's the Heartron where I'm pictured with a robot, a real sort of a scenario which is real now. And I thought it best to put it here to show you how things are in, even back here in Haryana, things are moving. AI, it's going to be 15% of India's current gross value in 2035. Next. So this is a very interesting joke. I just want to put it very short, but a data scientist goes for an interview and he could predict the questions of the, you know, person who's going to question him. And he said, I only knew what you're going to ask me because I interviewed all the people who you've interviewed before me. And when this man refuses to give him a job, that saying that, look, you, on ethical grounds, I can't promise you a job. He says, oh, it doesn't matter. I was only just field testing my prediction system. Interesting. Next. That's it. Thank you so much.
Can hold on to the mic. We have a couple of questions. So thank you so much, Dr. Karnika Seth. And I'm sure this legal capsule around importance of considering data related regulations at each step of your DS pipeline are going to serve you well. So we have a couple of interesting questions. I'm going to ask you just one. The rest of the two I'll send you across. So one of the participants here wants to know how data security can help in improving the judicial system and lawsuits in India where the data is supposed to be very sensitive and private.
Yes, data is very sensitive and private. And in the judicial system, how data science can help, right?
No, is so that, how can data security help in improving the judicial system?
Right, that's a very apt question for me because I have actually authored the manual for e-filing in across 18,000 district courts and 21 high courts are already using that e-filing manual. The whole court system is now on e-court basis where we can file any petition or any case online. It's a very safe, secure model. And very soon we are going to have new laws coming up for safety of electronic evidence and, you know, improving through AI, through blockchain, various security mechanisms. And the whole, as I see, data science and data security is going to enhance the whole infrastructure and framework of the judicial system, expediting the fast track court systems. We are already seeing a huge leap in terms of POXO court cases, you know, to fight child pornography and sexual abuse against children. There are fast track courts already set up. And child friendly video conferencing courts also set up. So a lot of data is secure. And I think in the long run, we also may be having an algorithm like we have in the US to actually automatedly decide a few things like, you know, maybe bail applications, but not at the moment. That's not happening immediately. But yes, long down the line, it may happen. And ODR systems will help, you know, online dispute resolution systems will help, like we're already having them in the US. And I think that has a huge role to play. In the whole, I would say, ecosystem of data security and judicial, you know, jurisprudence. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
It was a pleasure. And thank you, Wits Pune. Thank you, Sucheta. It's been a lovely, you know, opportunity to interact with you all. I've tried to shake and wake you up, but if I have not, and I've not been able to answer a few questions, and, you know, if you have queries, feel free to send an email across. Thank you so much.